Good morning.
Welcome to worship God here at Danville Congregational Church, United Church of Christ. We are a people of extravagant welcome, and we are so grateful that you have joined us here this morning.
We are an open and affirming congregation of the United Church of Christ, and please know that no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, whether you are have been able to gather with us in the sanctuary, whether you are joining us online this morning or perhaps watching us later on our YouTube channel, you are welcome in this space, for this is God's house, this is God's Zoom, and all are welcome in this space.
If you're new to our community, we are so glad that you've chosen to worship with us today. We hope we have an opportunity to greet you after worship. And if you're new online, we're glad that you've signed in this morning to join us online. We invite you to introduce yourself in the chat feature and to share whatever information you would like us to have about you.
We are so glad to have so many of our young friends with us today. Especially, I want to call out that this is Emma Grace's first Sunday in the sanctuary. We're excited that she is here with us. And Jackson and Jaden and Jasmine and Hazel, and I hope I'm not leaving out. We even got some of our big kids here too. So I would just want to let y'all know that there are activity bags for you, even teenagers, adults, if you want to use them, it's cool. And we want you to take those home though. Feel free to do that. And there's also plenty of books. So take a book, check it out, and then just leave it in the basket on your way out.
Later in the service, we'll have an opportunity to lift up our joys and concerns. You're worshiping with us here in the sanctuary. There are prayer cards in each pew. You're invited to write your joy or concern on a prayer card, and then later in the service, an usher will come by to collect those. If you're worshiping with us online, you're invited to type your joy or concern in the chat feature, and we will lift each one of those up at that time during our time of prayer.
And then following worship, you're all invited either out to the patio for a time of coffee, conversation, and community. I think we got the coffee working.
I think we got the coffee this
right
morning.
On. Thank you, Brett. And and those of you joining through Zoom, we'll open a set of breakout rooms for y'all to engage. One reminder that we ask at the end of worship, if you'll just wait in your pew and our ushers will dismiss you row by row.
Finally, as we're coming back together, as we're getting used to this new normal of being in community together, we ask that you just follow the community guidelines that are printed in your bulletin. And basically just always wear a mask and just respect people's physical space while you're here at DCC. We have a couple of announcements we'd like to highlight for you. The first is that today the Outreach Commission is meeting. They're meeting online, and that information is in your bulletin. I believe the meeting starts at 11 a.m.
And Amy will drop the Zoom link for that for those of you joining online. She'll drop that in the chat. She's helping us with the last minute tech thing. We are so grateful to our tech minister, Amy. Could we appreciate her at this moment? Woo! Many of you may remember 6 months ago, the tragedy that happened in this community with the killing of Tyrell Wilson. And so today, in remembrance of Tyrell and in the movement for compassion and justice, group of folks will be gathering, information is in your bulletin, we'll be gathering here in Danville to remember the life of Tyrell and to commit ourselves to ongoing the pursuit of justice in not only this case, but in the pursuit of justice for Black lives. So you're welcome to join us, join the community this afternoon at 3:00. And one other quick announcement, youth group, 5:00, Pet Rock Sunday, Joyce Clausen is cooking. That's all I need to tell you. Okay.
Oh, Joyce is cooking. I might come to youth group. Beloved friends, this is the day that God has made. It is a day to rejoice, to gather together in community, to worship our good and gracious God. And so let us do that now as we're led into our call to worship by Lucy Beaver.
Please rise in body, mind, or spirit and call me in our, and join me in our call to worship. Jesus asks the disciples, Who do people say I am? They answer, some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, and others say one of the prophets. But Jesus presses them, Who do you say I am? Peter answers, "You are Christ, God's anointed one, God with us." Now Jesus pushes us. What about you? Here in this moment, here in this community, who do you say I am? Where do we find the wisdom to answer?
Let us pray. Holy wisdom of God, you call to us from the depths of our hearts, where we long for connection with you and with one another. You call to us from busy streets and neighborhoods, where human pain and possibility are most urgent. You call to us from our sacred stories, where God, Christ, Spirit, create, challenge, comfort. Guide us, we pray, on an adventure of hope, and help us see with your eyes the way which lead to beloved community where Jesus Christ is at the center. Amen. Peace be with you. Let us greet one another with waves and smiles from where we are located.
You may be seated. This time I'd like to invite forward the candidates for baptism and their families. And if you could just line up right up here. Mom. And then if the family, so Lauren, Ben, why don't you come over here and stand with your daughters? Dear friends, as we come to this font of living water, let us recall the meaning of baptism. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ.
For by one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and all were made to drink of one Spirit. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. Jesus came to John to be baptized by him, but John tried to make him change his mind. I ought to be baptized by you, John said, yet you have come to me.
Jesus said, let it be so for now. For in this way, we shall do all that God requires. So John agreed. As soon as Jesus was baptized, he came out of the water. Then heaven was opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God coming down like a dove and lighting on him.
Then a voice said from heaven, this is my dear Son, with whom I am well pleased. At another time, Jesus said, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Baptism is the sacrament through which we are united to Jesus Christ and given part in Christ's ministry. Baptism is the visible sign of an invisible grace, the reconciliation of people to God. It shows the death of self and the rising to a life of service, discipleship, and praise. It shows also the pouring out of the Holy Spirit on those whom God has chosen as children of God. In baptism, God works in us the power of forgiveness, the renewal of spirit, and the knowledge of the call to be God's people always.
This is the water of baptism. Out of this water, we rise with new life, chosen as God's people and made one in Christ. Katie, Lucy, Anne, do you desire to be baptized into the faith and family of Jesus Christ? If so, please say, I do.
Lucy, Katie, Anne, do you renounce evil and injustice and desire the freedom of new life in Christ? If so, say, I do.
Do you profess Jesus as the center of your faith? If so, please say, I do.
Do you promise, by the grace of God, to be Christ's disciples, to follow in the way of Jesus, to resist oppression and evil, to show love and justice, and to witness to the work and the word of Jesus Christ as best as you are able? If so, say, I promise with the help of God.
Do you promise, according to the grace given you, to grow in the Christian faith and to be a faithful member of the Church of Jesus Christ, celebrating Christ's presence and furthering Christ's mission in all the world? If so, please say, I promise with the help of God.
And to the rest of us, Jesus Christ calls us to make disciples of all nations and to offer them the gift of grace in baptism. Do you, who witness and celebrate this moment, who witness and celebrate this sacrament, promise your love, support, and care to the ones about to be baptized as they live and grow in Christ?
I promise my love, support and care. I'd like to invite everyone to extend their hands forward as we bless this water. Holy One, may your Spirit pour out into these waters. By your Spirit, may we be cleansed of our sin and be your sanctified people. Create a new life in Ian, Katie, and Lucy baptized this day. May they rise in Christ. Glory to you, O God, the one who was and is and always shall be. Amen.
Amen.
Katie, you come forward. Laura and Ben, if you want to come forward too. Can you just put your hands on Katie, on her shoulders? Katie, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, one God, Mother of us all.
Lucy, your turn. Come forward. A friend, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God and Mother of us all. Amen.
And Anne, if you'd like to come forward. Antonio, if you want to just. And Elizabeth, if you just want to put your hands on Anne's shoulders, and Anne, just come a little closer. We'll get you that one. And I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God, Mother of us all. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Amen. Let us pray this prayer together. We give you thanks, O Holy One, Mother and Father of all people, for the ones baptized today, and for the grace acknowledged here today in water and the Holy Spirit. Embrace us all as sons and daughters in the one household of your love. Grant us grace to receive, nurture, and befriend these new members of the body of Christ. Give to the newly baptized strength for life's journey, courage in time of suffering, the joy of faith, the freedom of love, and the hope of new life through Jesus Christ, who makes us one. Amen.
You may return to your seats.
This morning, our scripture lesson comes to us from Mark chapter 8, verses 27 through 38. Hear these words. Jesus went on with his disciples to the village of Caesarea Philippi, and on the way he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they answered him, "John the Baptist and others, Elijah, and still others, one of the prophets." He asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered him, "You are the Messiah." And he sternly ordered them not to tell anyone about him. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all of this quite openly. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it. For those who lose their life for my sake, and for the sake of the gospel, will save it. For what will it profit them to gain their whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed,
what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. May God bless the hearing of these ancient words. Amen.
Friends, will you join me in a moment of prayer? Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on each one of us. And may the words of my mouth, the meditations of all our hearts together be acceptable and pleasing in your sight. For you are our rock, our strength, and our Redeemer. Amen. When I was 16, my parents, they gifted me a cross necklace that I wore probably every single day. I wore it to school. I wore it to cross country and swim practice. I wore it in the shower. Heck, I wore it to bed at night when I went asleep. That necklace became a part of me, an extension of my body. Twice it fell off when I wasn't looking, but both times it somehow landed in my hand. I thought that was a sign that it wasn't meant to be lost, a sign that someone somewhere wanted me to keep wearing that cross. But then one day, that cross went missing. I can't remember how exactly, it just went missing. It's probably buried in my childhood closet back in Boston, Massachusetts. I loved that cross necklace. Crosses. If you keep an eye out, you'll see them everywhere. We hang them in our homes. We wear them around our necks. We tattoo them to our arms. We give them as gifts. We stick them to the back windows of cars. We pound them into the earth to mark a grave. They come in all shapes and sizes. Some are made of gold, and others are just splintered wood. Some are shiny and detailed, others simple and plain. I think all these crosses are a good thing. What do you think? Because as Jesus says in our gospel lesson, we are to be cross-carrying people. If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. But the question that comes to mind is, what does that even mean, right? What does it mean to take up your cross? Does it mean that what I have so often heard, that is, our crosses are the sufferings each of us bear? Is that what it means? You know the phrase, I guess this is just my cross to bear. It's a phrase we throw around for both inconveniences and catastrophes in life. That annoying person at work, just my cross to bear. You know what I mean. That mass in my lung, just my cross to bear. A leaky roof, just my cross to bear. child with a behavior challenge. Just my cross to bear. We say it as if these are assignments handed down from God that either teach us a lesson or test our faith or punish us for bad behavior. And the guidance given is usually not very helpful. Just endure it. Jesus had to suffer, and so must you. It is your cross to bear. Just hang in there for a bit. Now, if that is how the text is supposed to be understood, then I fear that it has become rotten to the core and hollowed out of any meaning and depth, justifying suffering and denigrating God. The problem is, as we often do, we have lifted this verse out of Mark's gospel, out of the context in which it was written, and disconnected it from what it was supposed to be for. Jesus has told his disciples that the road on which he is headed just before this leads to straight into suffering and betrayal and rejection and ultimately to death. Peter wants nothing to do with this road, with this journey. No king of Israel, no savior of God's people can suffer, be rejected, and die. The savior of the world must come in power and might. So Peter pulls Jesus aside and he tries to straighten him out and show him that he can't go down a path of suffering and death, to which Jesus barks back at Peter saying, "Get behind me, Satan. Do not tempt me with any easier way. You've put your mind on human things and not divine things." And there it is. Human things versus divine things. Jesus says Peter is focusing on human things, but wanting to avoid suffering. But divine things, Jesus says, includes the realities of life, like suffering, like pain, like disappointment and despair, fear and isolation. Jesus is saying these are all divine things. But these are not divine things because God has handed them out to unsuspecting people. They are divine because God has walked straight into these places of suffering and pain so as to be with God's people. Jesus said he must undergo suffering and rejection and be killed. Jesus marks and claims the sufferings of this world as the very place where he will be found. These are the divine things. After seminary, I think I've told you this before, but I was a chaplain at a hospital in Boston for a summer. And I would receive requests from patients or their families to go and visit a patient. And many times I would come into a room where there would be a patient who was sleeping or unconscious with tubes and machines hooked up all over them. And I was terrified. I was so scared. When they weren't awake or no family was around, I would breathe a sigh of relief and I would slowly back out of the room unnoticed. I would leave my card, just letting them know a chaplain came to visit, but I was so relieved, and I never felt really good about that. I never felt really good about the relief that I felt. Like Peter, I wanted to avoid any suffering, any pain that I could possibly encounter with this person lying in the hospital bed. One time, I was called to a room of a 22-year-old patient. He just suffered a major stroke. When I got to his room, no family was around, but by the grace of God, I found the courage to just stick around and be present to this man who was unconscious. His parents eventually came into the room. We prayed together. We held hands and we cried together. And I believe that God was there. It's one of those feelings that you can't describe, right? God was there in that moment. The human thing is to avoid any suffering, any pain like Peter. But Jesus won't do that. And then Jesus says, if any want to be my followers, let them deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. If we put this verse back into its context, we can see that it isn't about God handing out assignments for suffering and for pain, but it is about God entering into the very suffering and pain of the world. So let's be clear. Your suffering is not the cross Jesus is talking about. Your pain, your disappointment, your despair, that is not the cross. Jesus isn't talking about tolerating a bothersome boss. Jesus isn't talking about enduring cancer. Jesus is not calling us to passive acceptance of suffering and pain. The cross Jesus is talking about is not the one that's on your back. It's the one that's on your forehead. The cross that has marked you long ago as a beloved child of God. A mark that says, with you is where God chooses to be. Never separate from and never beyond the presence of God. You have been marked with a particular cross, the cross of Christ. In baptism and in blessing, you, each and every one of you, have been claimed by God. God has stamped you with a cross that cannot wash off. So take up your cross, that cross, and follow me, Jesus says, into a desperate and dangerous world filled with suffering and with pain, disappointment and despair, fear. And God says, that's where I'll be. And I need you there too. Bringing about peace and mercy, beauty and justice, take up your cross and follow me, Jesus says. You've been marked with a cross, meaning you have been claimed by God. Therefore, to place a cross somewhere is to proclaim that place, that person as claimed, as beloved by God. There's a story about a congregation in Kentucky. The congregation is in a town that has become littered with violence. In fact, the town was once the murder capital of the United States. It was all over in the news, and it worried many of the residents of the town. And it was joked about by morning DJs on morning talk shows. It has become an infection for this town, they said. Well, the pastor of this particular congregation, he decided that another word needed to be spoken by the church. And so one Saturday, on an impulse, he took the processional cross from the church and he went to all the places in the town where violence had occurred in the past week, placed the cross in that spot. And he prayed for the victims of violence and for the ones who brought about the violence. Now, eventually, word began to trickle out into the community about what this pastor was doing. And now, every Saturday, a group of community members goes to the places of violence and puts the cross there to say, even here, even in this place of deep and dark, destructive violence, this place is not outside the reach of God. God has entered into this very place and claimed it. God is taking it into God's own being. God will not avoid it. God will enter into it. And so to place a cross somewhere, in a ditch on the side of a road, around your neck, on your arm, in your living room, or into the hands of a confirmation student or a new member, it's to mark that place, that person, as a divine thing, a sacred thing, a holy thing. To say, this is where God will be present. And you, my dear friends, have been marked with a cross. When we baptized Lucy and Katie and Anne, we didn't just pour water over their heads as a promise of safety and security and protection. We poured over their heads the promise of unconditional value and love amid a world that can sometimes tell us otherwise. We marked them with a cross that says, your life, it's no longer your own, but it has been claimed by God as beloved. That God will be with each of them, all of us, in all the days of our lives. And in a moment, when we welcome our confirmation students, and when we welcome our new members into the fullness, the richness of the life of this community, they will be given a cross, a reminder that they have been marked, marked with the cross of Christ, which you carry into your life, into the world. It is a cross that claims you. It's a cross that blesses you and sends you out into this tattered world to be extensions of grace and mercy and love. Jesus said, take up the cross and follow me. May this be so. Amen.
Thank you.
Friends, this is indeed a joyful day in the life of our church, where we welcome into the fullness of life here in this community, 3 confirmation students and 4 new members. It's been a special joy to accompany these folks to this point in their journey and to look forward to their full participation in the life of this church.
So about this time last year, Lucy, Katie, and Paloma began the confirmation process, which was done through Zoom for 9 months, along with 22 or so other young people from Congregational Church of San Mateo and First Church Berkeley. And so these young people hung in there for 9 months in the middle of Sunday afternoon to complete a rather unique confirmation process. So I'm going to invite them to come forward. Lucy Beaver with your mentor, Betty Felton, if you want to come up. Katie Beaver and your mentor, Nan Carnes. And Paloma Jackson Kimball with your mentor, Heidi Bridgman.
We also have 4 new folks joining us into full membership in the life of the church. And I want to note that what's interesting is that these folks have never worshiped with us in person, except for 2 of them today, and 2 are still online with us, which is why we have the TV monitor in here. And so I'm going to invite up Stephanie and Chris Tadeo. There they are. And then I'm going to invite up Ann Bremer and Antonio Moran.
Stand behind her.
Friends in Christ, we are all received into the church through the sacrament of baptism. Our confirmation students and our candidates for membership have found nurture and support in this family of Jesus Christ. They have been led by the Holy Spirit to affirm their baptism and to claim in our presence their covenantal relationship with Christ and the members of this church, Danville Congregational Church. They are here for service to God, using the gifts which the Holy Spirit bestows.
So we have some questions for all of you and for you, Chris and Stephanie. Wow, this is really unique. What a blessing. Respecting divine mystery beyond our human knowing, revealed but not contained in the stories of our faith, will you strive to walk humbly with God? If so, say, I will.
I will.
Celebrating the fullness of Jesus's witness flowing from the baptismal waters at the River Jordan and the stories of bread broken and shared, do you confess the God made known in the one we call Christ? If so, please say, I do.
I do.
Believing Jesus about God and trusting his example, will you accept the cost and the joy of following him? Welcoming the unwelcomable, speaking the unspeakable, touching the untouchable, and suffering the insufferable. If so, will you please say, I will.
I will.
Honoring the spirit revealed in the paradoxical, will you live the questions of our faith, open to the continuing revelation of our still speaking God? If so, please say, I will.
I will.
Discerning strength and vulnerability, acknowledge your interdependence and mutual accountability with all of creation. If so, will you please say, I do.
I do.
Claiming God's grace abundant in our common life, will you covenant together to cherish inquiry, embrace diversity, and honor vulnerability? If so, please say, I will.
I will.
Okay, one last question. As a member of this faith community, Do you covenant to participate in the life and mission of this family of God's people? If so, please say, I do.
I do.
Beloved friends, let us extend our hands in a sign of blessing over these confirmation students and these new members, and let us pray together. We rejoice, O merciful God, with these young people who of their own accord have made their declarations of faith. We rejoice, O loving God, with these new friends who have chosen to join this community of faith. And we rejoice, O compassionate God, in the gift of the Holy Spirit and in the Spirit's power to awaken us to new truth and to inspire us to venture into fullness of life. We give you thanks that each of them has moved to affirm their baptism. Help them to live not for themselves, but for Christ and those whom Christ loves. Keep them steady and abounding in hope, never giving up, pressing always toward the goal of life with you in Jesus Christ. Amen.
Friends, let us, the members of Danville Congregational Church, United Church of Christ, express our welcome and affirm our mutual ministry in Christ by reading our church's covenant printed in your bulletin.
We are
united in striving to know the will of God as taught in the Holy Scriptures and to walk in the ways of God made known or to be made known to us. We hold it to be the mission of the church to proclaim the gospel to all humankind, to exalt the worship of the one God, and labor to advance knowledge, promote justice, further the reign of peace, and realize our common humanity, depending, like the faithful before us, on the continuing guidance of our Creator to lead us all into truth. We work and pray for the transformation of the world into the kingdom of God. We promise to sustain and cherish our spiritual home, to take part in its worship, seek its increase, and share its work in faith, hope, and love.
My friends, I just want to take a moment and congratulate you and formally welcome you to Danville Congregational Church. We are thrilled that you are here among us. Thank you to God. So we have these little gifts for you. And like I said, each getting across today, to remind you that God is always with you, wherever you are in this world. In this life. And then I also have, which I neglected, your baptismal certificates for those that got baptized today.
And we also want to present you with a copy of God's Word that it may accompany you. Let's see, and we'll talk about this after. Lucy, Katie, and Paloma behind the TV.
Friends, go in peace, serve God, and walk humbly in the way of Jesus.
Amen.
You may return to your seats.
Friends, we come to this point in our service where we will enter into the solidarity of prayer with one another and with those gathered with us online. If there is a joy or concern that you have written on one of the cards, would you hold it up so that our ushers can come by and bring it forward? We have a few requests come by email, and then we'll go to our folks online who are invited to type their prayers in the chat. Friends, let's enter into the solidarity of prayer with a moment of silence. Peace and in love and in joy, we pray to you, O God. We know that you are here with us, as near to us as our very breath. God, there may be things we hold in the silence of our heart, and we know that through your Holy Spirit, you hold those things too difficult for words with us. I invite you now to, as we pray, to respond with "Hear our prayer." For all people in their daily life and work, for our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone, God, hear our prayer. For this community, the nation, and the world, for all who work for justice, freedom, and peace, God, hear our prayer. For the just and proper use of your creation, for the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression, God. For all who are in need of healing of body, mind, or spirit, and for all who suffer. For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble. For the poor and the poor in spirit. And for those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and those in need. Hear our prayer. For the peace and unity of the Church of God, for all who proclaim the gospel, and to all who seek the truth, God, hear our prayer. For our pastors, our leadership team, our commissioners, our lay leaders, ministers, and all who serve God in this church, God, hear our prayer. And for the special joys, needs, and concerns of this congregation we now attend. From Randy and Janice Jang. We give thanks to God for the life of Edward Jang, who passed away peacefully during an afternoon nap. He was able to live a full life and proudly make it to 100 years old. Dad is now with Mom, his lifelong dance partner. God, in your great love. Lisa Phillips asked us to pray. After many years of praying, our sweet young neighbors were blessed with a new baby in January. Now, just months later, the new mother was diagnosed with breast cancer. She underwent radical surgery and begins chemo this week. Please pray for God's mercy on this family, for miraculous healing, and for many helping hands to lift them up and carry them through the days ahead. God, in your mercy and your healing. Judy Haldane asked for prayers for a successful surgery this Friday and for a fast recovery. God, in your mercy and your healing. Anne's mom, Elizabeth, invites us to pray for Anne and Antonio's finding joy and making their life together. God, in your great love and mercy. Hear our prayer. Amy? No prayer requests coming out online? Okay. I'd like to invite us into a moment of silence again as we think of those over 3,000 lives lost 20 years ago in the 9/11 terrorist attack, including the hundreds of first responders who lost their lives trying to save others. Dear God, 20 years after this horrifying attack, we continue to pray. We pray for the fallen, the ones loved so dearly and missed so deeply. We have entrusted them to you and ask you to continue to embrace them in your love. We also pray for the crestfallen. This anniversary marks a time of so much sadness and grief for so many. We ask for your care and comfort for the living and remind us again and again that you are with us as you always have been. And we pray for those who have been targets of xenophobia and hate, those who live in fear because of their ethnicity, race, or religion. Remind us again, O God, to love our neighbors as ourselves. And we pray together, mindful that we are not alone in our sorrow or fear, because you are with us and we are here with one another. And may this anniversary remembrance of 9/11 prompt us to consider how we reach across other walls, finding common cause with those who seek to break down dividing walls of hostility. We thank you, O God, that your love, the very cross of Jesus, is stamped upon each one of us as a reminder that with us is where you choose to be. And so uphold us by your Spirit. Abide with us as we each take up our crosses and follow our sibling Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our loving God, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I have a written invitation tip for you to give to this church, and I'm just not saying it. Because if anything tells you about our church, it's what we've done this morning. And I'm just really just awestruck by our old members who I see for the first time in 15 months, and for all of our new members and guests who are here. This is what we are about. And I'm sorry, I'm choked up. I didn't realize this would happen. But nothing could be better testament to what this church does and who we are. So that said, I was also struck by the first hymn we sang. And inside that hymn, there's, I think it's the last verse, and it talks and says, our currency is love, and our kindness is our law. And I don't need to say anything else. You may give online. If you've already made a gift, you can make it by check or automated giving. And of course, we are grateful for any gift today. Please leave it in the basket in the back if you want to do something manual, or sign up and give via our website. Dear God, please bless these gifts, all the gifts we give of love and talent and hands, and bless the givers and bless those that we are giving to every day in every way. Amen. Thank you.
kiss your row, starting from the back all the way to the front. Before you leave this morning, go with this blessing. Jesus says, take up your cross and follow him. It is a cross that claims you. It is a cross that blesses you. So take up that cross. Go out into this tattered world and be God's extensions of grace, mercy, beauty, and love. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.